So I'm going to talk about developing embedded development, embedded domain specific languages using Boost.Spirit. I'm going to give a very brief introduction about Expertise Solutions, which is the company that I work for. And we do open source and closed source library and application development. And we have good experience in C and C++ development. And we do developments from distributed systems to user interface in embedded systems. So we cover a lot of areas for software development. And we are located in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. So the EDSL that I'm going to talk about, the development of that is going to has been done in the library called Morbid, which was an experiment to bring CORBA to modern C++. CORBA is a very, very old protocol and API for distributed development, distributed systems development. And we tried to make an experiment trying to use modern C++ to create a library for CORBA development. And it uses Boost.Spirit for all generation and parsing, from parsing IDL and binary communication to generating C++ from the IDL compiler and for binary communication. So we also use Boost type eraser for object references. So we try to actually, instead of creating a base library that use oriented object for inheritance to be able to make it available the objects in the distributed system, we actually use Boost type eraser where we created concepts which type eraser is able to make the type eraser of the implementation that is made of the for that object. And we use Boost eraser for network and an EDSL for binary communication, okay, which is actually the subject of this presentation. If anyone has any questions, can raise your hand, okay, at any time. So the overview of the presentation, we're going to talk a little bit about Boost.Spirit V2, so to give a very brief demonstration of what Boost.Spirit is about. Then we're going to talk about how we started writing parsers for CORBA in Boost.Spirit, and then how we started writing generators for CORBA using Boost.Spirit. And then we're going to talk about how we did to write the EDSL for using Boost.Spirit. Okay, and in the end, we'll try to talk about Spirit X3, which is a newer version of Boost.Spirit for parsing. I think it's still experimental, isn't it, Joel? And it's not meant for Boost.Spirit is not meant right now to substitute replace Boost.Spirit V2, if I'm not correctly.
There will be no replacement, but it's no longer in an experimental stage. But we choose to keep X3 because it's already, well, it's been a few years now when we've been using the name X3 for a long time. So
I see. So Boost.Spirit X3 is not an experimental anymore.
By Friday I plan to have a release for X3. Oh. But it will coexist with V2 and Classic. So there will be three versions.
Okay. Unfortunately, in Spirit X3, we don't have the karma generation like we do in Spirit V2, so it's not a real replacement yet. So Boost.Spirit, it's a library to write parsers and generators. It uses a parsing expression grammar as a EDSL in C++, so you can write the grammar to which you are going to parse or generate text. And one example is a very simple example that I actually extract from the Boost.Spirit documentation. You write, this is the grammar between the parentheses, and use the character open parentheses So it has to pass the open parts. Then you have a double, and then optionally, following that, optionally a commas followed by a double, and then close the parentheses or just a double, and that can be it's passed and can be, and you can have an attribute. Here is the V, for example. You use a boost fusion sequence where you're going to receive the passed data from the text. Okay. Any questions here on this part? I think most who is not familiar with Boost Spirit here. Okay. And that is the generation. You can see that it's very like the other. And you say that you have you're going to have a double, or this is for alternative, okay? Or you have a parenthesis followed by a double, followed by optionally a comma followed by a double, okay? And then a parenthesis, closing parenthesis. And then it's going to use the data that is in this boost fusion sequence to generate the actual text for this grammar, okay? So that this is that since the talk is very very short, I didn't do a very big introduction to Boost Spirit. So if anyone has any questions, we can talk later after the presentation too. Okay. And then how we try to write parsers and generators using Boost Spirit directly. That was Boost Spirit V2, and how we fare doing that. Okay. So this is how a protocol for a CORBA messages is laid out in the OMG standard. So it says here that it has four octets with the value GIOP, followed by an octet with the major version, octet of the minor version, a boolean saying which byte order, which little endian or big endian, followed by the message type, which is an enumeration, but it's actually an octet, followed by the unsigned long, which is the message size. And after here, we have the message header. After here, we have the byte of the message. Okay, so this is how this is specified. And we want to create a parser and generator for this standard. Okay, so GIOP is actually a generic grammar. And which, for example, it doesn't specify directly how an octet is laid out on that stream. But there is concrete protocols like IIOP, which stands for Internet Inter-Orb Protocol, which you use TCP for communication. And then it specifies that octet is actually one byte with eight bits and like that. And so you have a way to actually send messages for a CORBA and receive messages from other orbs. So what we try to do is use the same way with Spirit used. So we created actually a octet terminal and a string terminal, which has a different layout for communication, and followed by a sequence of octets, which this is your shot. No, this is not exactly the same mess, but. It has the octet, the string. No, this is not the same, but it's just an example. And you say that it's four bytes with GIOP, the string, followed by a few octets, a string, and you long shot, and a sequence of octets. This is actually a directive, what's called in Boost Spirit. And we pass another pass inside the directive, and that actually passes the inside passes in a different way. So it's actually a sequence of octets, so this is going to be a standard vector of unsigned SHA, for example, as a result. And this is how we started trying to write the parser, okay? And we can actually see that we can create custom parsers for Boost Spirit. So that's how we try to make it work on Boost Spirit. We create we specialize make permit inside Boost.Spirit G, and we say which kind of parser that's going to return. For example, this is a string parser, okay? And this is the tag for the terminal, okay? This Boost.Spirit terminal here defines the tag and creates the object that's going to be used as a special grammar, for the special grammar. So here we return the string parser that's actually going to do the work here to extract the string from the actual text that is going to be passed. Okay, so this is actually pretty straightforward. It's very common on Boost.Spirit grammars, a little more advanced grammars, to create our own custom parsers or custom directives too. Okay, and this is actually the definition of the string parser. So we say that it's a primitive parser because it does not a directive, and it's not actually doesn't have two. It's not, for example, an operator that receives multiple parsers and orders that. It's actually a terminal parser, so it's a primitive parser. We're actually going to write imperative code here in the bool pass function, receive the iterators for write that's passed, the context, the skipper, and the attributes. The attributes is where I'm going to, this parser is going to make the assignment of the results of the passing to that attribute here. So hopefully that's going to be a standard string. It could be something else, but we may push back that as a container. And this says it's actually the normal attribute. This is for Boost.Spirit V2. On Spirit X3 is easier to create custom parsers, okay? So this is actually reasonably straightforward to do. But we started writing the generation later. And the generation, you can see that's exactly, it's mostly the same, it's very similar, okay? And here we put the data for the what's going to be generated, and we generate on top of this same grammar, okay? And then we can do the same things that we did that with the make primitive. We're going to partially specialize the generator, create a generator, and then we are going to generate from the data that we receive as attributes. We are going to actually use an output iterator. We're going to assign the textual representation for that. And one thing that we noticed that they are quite similar. And this is very, very common. We've seen that this is very common for format specifications, okay? And yet they're not at all compatible because it's not, they are asymmetrical for the operators. One uses the shift left, the others use the shift right. And there's another problem that was how to cope with endianness and alignment, because when you're going to write an unsigned an integer inside a COBA message, that has to be aligned on the size of that integer. And it doesn't matter how many, doesn't matter what is before, it matters that it has to have an offset that is divisible by that size. So, and endianness and alignment, it can be scoped because we might have what's called encapsulations that are going to parse in a single pass. But at the same time, endianness and alignment has to cross rules and grammars barriers. So the endianness that from another rule that encloses other rules inside that, they have to pass that information along on the endianness. And one possibility was to use parameters for all grammars and rules. And but that was actually very manual work, and it actually made the grammar very much worse to work with that. And we had to pass that information to locals, and then to locals have to pass that as a parameter for the grammar. So it was actually very, it was not pleasant to write parsers and generators, having to worry about endianness information and alignment information for every single parser that you're going to do on. So we thought how we can solve the alignment and endianness in a way that's orthogonal to the grammar assembly or writing of the grammar. Yeah. And The other thing is, can I write just one grammar for generation and passing, since they are mostly the same? And then actually what we thought was, why am I writing parsers and generates on the first place? I already have a language. That's the language that I have to work with. And all I need is actually to embed this language into C++. So if I can do this, I don't have to worry about having to write parsers and generators. I actually just write the format, and the format could actually create the parser and generator for me. Okay. So, and it can be very similar to Boost.Spirit, as we saw before on the parser and generator. They are actually just different terminals for different data types, and then they are actually very similar. So, what we looked into Boost.Spirit's implementation, and we've seen that Boost Karma and Boost.Spirit Chi and Boost.Spirit Karma actually uses a same set of code that is called Boost.Spirit Support. And in that Boost.Spirit Support, it's actually built Karma and Chi over that. And then we try to see if we could use the same Boost.Spirit Support to write other ADSLs based on Boost.Spirit. And that's one example that you actually got working, for example. And we say that this is a directive, and say that this whole parser inside here, actually this whole grammar, it's not necessarily a parser, it could be a generator, has a certain endianness. This endianness here, it has to pass an octet here for our endianness, and then it passes that information as context for all the next grammar information. So we used another operator because that operator doesn't have a directional implication, okay? And we actually do is we compile this grammar to a parser using another domain. So we say, this is the grammar I have, and I want this to become a Boost.Spirit parser. And then I compile that and use Boost.Spirit pass to pass this grammar as a parser, okay? So the result of GIOP compile is actually a parser that you can use inside another Boost.Spirit Chi grammar, for example. So you can say actually, you can use an asterisk here and say that zero or more of this, for example. Or you can create a parser that you actually do that for IOR, which is we have a parser that first is unx the whole sequence and then passes that as for the parser inside that as a directive. And so we just say unx here, and then we can say that this whole grammar is going to work with an x text. And it's going to be unxed as a binary, and then that's going to be passed by this parser here, okay? So how did we write this here, okay? We saw that Boost.Spirit Chi has a domain, and Boost.Spirit Karma has another domain. And that domain separates on how that it's going to be compiled, and actually which grammar is actually possible for Boost Proto, okay? Which grammar is valid for that, okay? So what we did was create another grammar, okay? It's used to transform proto expression to actually a parser generated, which the parser is going to call the parser, okay? And this meta compiler is actually a huge switch, a meta switch inside Boost.Spirit Support. And that's how it actually works for Boost.Spirit Karma and Boost.Spirit Chi in a way that you don't have to work with Boost Proto directly, because the meta compiler abstracts that away and into terminals and directives and operators, okay? And then we can create our own domains. So what we did is we created one domain. We have both domains. So we created a generator domain for the COBA and a parser domain for that, okay? We saw that we're using that, the parser domain there, okay? This GIOP compile actually just calls the compiler for the Boost.Spirit support passing that as another domain, okay? So what happens is the meta compiler it's actually transforms a Boost.Spirit proto expression based on other templates. So what it actually does is it looks on the on that proto expression, and if he sees a terminal, it if he sees some kind of object expression, it uses a make component with a tag, so that it can actually instantiate the parser or the generator, okay? And it's also templated on the domain. So you, for example, Boost.Spirit Karma, it specializes this template using Boost.Spirit Karma domain, while the Boost.Spirit Qi does the same for to make components, doing specializing that on the domain for the Boost.Spirit Qi. Okay, so what we did was we went there and created our own domain, and then we specialized partially, in this case actually explicitly specialized for example tag terminals. So wherever there is a terminal, we call another template that is a make primit. That's exactly the same way that Boost.Spirit Qi and Boost.Spirit Karma does, but this adds a few more instantiations. But we actually did not want to try. We want to follow the same guidelines for the implementation that Boost.Spirit Qi and Boost.Spirit Karma was using. But we could actually just do directly here. For example, we could use another kind of typedef here instead of doing another make primit, for example. But we use the make primit, and actually here, for example, we have also the tag directive, for example, for the sequence open for directives on that grammar too. Okay, so this make primitive is actually another template completely. We define that in our own namespace. So Boost.Spirit Qi, for example, has a make primitive, and a Boost.Spirit Karma also has another make primitive in different namespaces. And each specialization for this domain calls for the make primitive in each namespace. Okay. So what we do now is just we specialize make primit on based on whatever is the actual terminal. So if it has a tag string, for example, that's because you are using the Boost.Spirit terminal string. Okay, so we specialize on that, and we say that the string generator, we're going to return a string generator. Here we have a value, okay, and we don't use this second argument, okay, and we just return the string generator for that, okay. And the same thing for our tag directive, and we're going to have a make directive, okay, and then we're going to also specialize, define a make directive inside our own namespace, and specialize that for each directive. So, for example, that's the specialization for the endianness directive that actually passes an octet that has a boolean, and then it passes that information for the parsers or generators that it has embedded in it, which is actually the subject there. Okay, so it receives a subject, which is the what is inside those okay brackets. For the operators, actually, also we specialize then, saying that you want this other operator here to work. Okay. Any questions until now? At this point, no. And then, how we solved endianness and alignment? Because we hadn't solved that before using Boost.Spirit, using Qi directly or Karma directly. But how we now that we have a new EDSL, we can actually work with this is the endianness is actually since it's a directive, it's actually also a parser and a generator. This is the Boolean parse received iterators, and that this is the part of that implementation. So we actually use a octet pass, and we create a new attribute that's going to be passed for a new context that we are going to pass this new context for our subject. And that this context now is going to have the information for what endianness you are going to use. So, for example, the integer parser for our EDSL can actually check the endianness information from its context. It's going to receive the context and it can ask, do you have an endianness information? And if it has an endianness information, it's going to know which value that is. So it becomes transparent for the grammar, or the endianness passing information for that. It just becomes embedded in the context, and that context can be checked on in complete time because it actually uses a fusion sequence, okay, as that information. And also, because we need to write rules and grammars that are going to be used as both generators and as parsers, we have to actually template rules and grammars in its domain. Okay, so and for the endianness, we actually pass the endianness information also as an attribute as a parameter. Okay, transparently, and alignment information is always in context. Actually, endianness is also in context. This is not very correct, but they're all context here. Okay. And this is how we actually wrote the message message grammar for the 1.0 version of the GIOP. Okay, so we just say it starts with a GIOP, and it has an octet with the major version of 1, minor version 0. Endianness here is actually 2, passes the octet here, and passes that information of endianness for the rest of the message. So you also say the message type is actually here as it's a constant there, passes as a non-type template parameter. And this is another directive where we say that this is it has to pass the unsigned long that has 32 bits, and that unsigned long possesses the size, the maximum size of that body there. That body is also the rest of the grammar. So we also receive the body as a template, as a constructor parameter. And that's how we actually do to, we have done to compose grammars inside grammars. So the same message header is used, for example, for a request or for a reply. So what we actually do is we instantiate a request grammar, and then we pass that as a body for a message header body, and then we compose the whole message with a requested and header for the information. And the attribute is also templated, so you can have the attribute for the whole message in one go. Okay. Any questions until now? So for as our conclusion for this development was that we can create even more specifically tailored embedded domain specific languages using Boost.Spirit V2 with very little effort. The most effort was actually reading Boost.Spirit code and try to understand what that did. And after that was actually very easy. It's just partially specialized in code. And if you're actually accustomed to meta programming and Boost.Spirit code is actually not that hard to follow too. But if you are not very much into using Boost Proto in Boost.Spirit V2, things can get a little complicated to understand. It makes dealing with some aspects, such as alignment and endianness, in this specific case, a lot easier and transparent while writing the grammar itself. Boost Proto is almost completely abstracted away when extending and creating new EDSL in Boost Spirit, which is very good because writing Boost Proto transforms is not very easy to do. And when you have an error with transforming Boost Proto, it can get a very huge error and very hard to understand where you actually error. It abstracts actual parsing and generation. You actually write a format specification, and that becomes both the parser and generator for that format, for that specification of that format. Okay, so it's actually easier to write the format specification because we already have that format specification somewhere, so you don't have to think as a parser or as a generator. And the Boost Spirit power of combination makes it easier to parse and generate complex messages. Okay, so because of you can embed grammars inside grammars and other rules, and you can actually say that you have a grammar and you can say this is zero or more of that grammar, or optionally that grammar, and so on. So it's very easy to actually combine grammars with other grammars in Boost Spirit. Okay. Any questions so far? So we did I did an experiment with Boost Spirit X3, okay, and I've pushed that to that URL in GitHub. I thought that it was a lot easier to add custom primitives. So there is no make primitive. You just write the actual object that is going to generate the that's going to be using the expression template, and that if it's, for example, a directive, that can be, it's going to have an overloaded operator that returns the actual parser. And if you don't have that, you just instantiate the parser as a constant global and without any state. So it's actually a lot less code to write for Boost Spirit X3. But it doesn't have a meta compilation phase. That means that it doesn't have that domain and compile that is in Boost Spirit V2. So the solution for make primitive and make directive and specialize that on domains, it's not possible for Boost Spirit X3. Okay, but Boost Spirit X3 doesn't have another domain as well because it only passes right now. So it doesn't have a generator. So that doesn't have. It hasn't been an issue right now for Boost Spirit X3. And I think we should think of integrating parsing generators in EDSLs for Boost Spirit X3 and avoid asymmetric operators, because that actually makes it easier to reuse the same grammar for both generation and parsing. And when you're actually using auto parsers and auto generators, where that actually uses the not exactly auto parsers, auto generators, is when you have a the parser doesn't it returns exactly the same value, the attribute for each parser as a sequence of fusion sequence. So it's you don't get to write too much actions for that grammar because you just use the parser and then it returns for you a fusion sequence. And for use some parsers and generators, I try to use a map for as attributes. I thought that could be very useful, but that was trying to use to write a HTTP parser and generator. Because sometimes you don't have the same order for generation and as parser as you have for some format specifications. So it would be good to actually be able to write octet and say to each the name for that attribute that you're going to write. For example, if that is the URL, or if that's actually a MIME type inside that fusion, the attribute that you're passing. Okay. And questions and answers.
This actually symmetric operator.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's the ampersand.
I've used the percent, yes. Here.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so are you saying that with X3 we don't have that?
Actually, I've wrote the same grammar for Boost.Spirit. Ah, yeah.
Because we don't have the generator, so I'm not using that.
Let me repeat the question. Okay. The question was if in Boost.Spirit X3, if you have to be able to use this bitwise operators, right? And right now Boost.Spirit X3 actually implements only for parser, so it uses the shift left or shift right operator. So actually implemented the same grammar for Boost.Spirit X3 while doing both generations and passing, but it required that the actual objects that I was using the expression have to be both parsers and generators at the same time. So since there is no actually generators for Boost.Spirit X3, I invented a concept for a generator, and that is complicated because you have to use different names for different type defs inside the same object, and I'm saying that this one is for generator, the other is for passing. And right now, Boost.Spirit X3 doesn't actually qualify that type def as being a parser or not, so it uses the same type def, a neutral name for the type def, and we just have to actually create the operator for the bitwise operator. It's not very difficult, no. But you have to ask Finai that if that's a generator or parser, or if it's actually both. And so it gets the ask Finai is going to actually increase the instantiation too, for the template instantiation. So that's one thing to keep in mind, because not all grammars can be both things at the same time. Okay, but I've actually used the bitwise operator because it seemed like to have a very good I forgot the name precedence. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Another question. Okay, so. Thank you.